Peace and blessings, everyone. Welcome to Spotlight. I'm Edgy Wenka, and we have a very informative program for you. With me is Mr. Jeffrey Brooks. He is the curator of the Maritime Museum in H. Lavery South Community College. He's just written a new book. It's called Building a Virgin Island Sloop, The Story of Seamoon. And it's a beautiful, well illustrated book by Ty Durant. And we're going to talk to him about that, how to build a Virgin Island sloop. Also, we have with us Ms. Shayna Smith and Judy Haycraft. We're going to be talking about the upcoming leader cast. You know, they're interested in raising leaders here in the Virgin Islands. And it's going to be a big event. This, I think, is either the second or third annual leader cast at H. Lavery South Community College, Eileen L. Parsons Auditorium. They'll be talking to us about that. And we're going to have also Ms. Laura Lee Connor. She is the Gender Affairs Coordinator, along with Dr. Ronald McEnany and Mr. Marcus Hawley. We're going to be talking about Domestic Violence Awareness Month, along with building healthy relationships. There's a protocol to be signed soon. There is the Status of Children Act. There's a host of stuff that's happening in gender affairs in the Ministry of Health and Social Development. So we're going to be talking about all of that tonight. Of course, we have Sean Rose here with the events, the news, and the stories making headlines this week in the news. So we're going to go to Sean Rose. Sean, what's happening out there in the news world?
Good evening, Ajarenka. Good evening, viewers. This evening, we're going to take a look at what happened when legislators convened for the first sitting of the second session of the second House of Assembly, or the third session of the second House of Assembly, on Monday, where the governor unveiled what was considered to be an ambitious legislative agenda. He pointed to some 48 pieces of legislations that are expected to come in the later half of 2013, or should I say the later quarter of 2013, and also into 2014 as government seeks to stimulate the BVI economy, focusing on all sectors. In fact, the governor pointed out that in 2012, some 11 pieces of legislation were passed, and already for this year, another 13 pieces have been passed. So the government is working primarily, and what they're saying is that in the months and also in the year to come, they expect to do a lot more to basically streamline the Virgin Islands economy in light of what's happening on a global scale.
And what sort of measures or initiatives are they planning to take to improve the economic activity in the territory?
Well, in 2012, 13 pieces of legislation, they covered, for example, Customs Management and Duties Amendment Act, and one would assume that that was geared at reducing the cost of imports at the respective ports in terms of consumer goods. Whether or not that has materialized is up for debate.
Was that the legislation that allowed duties to be charged only on the invoice and not on
freight
and insurance?
Precisely. And then you had the Marriage Amendment Act, which was geared to ensuring that the BVI tourism sector remains competitive, and the BVI is seen as an ideal destination for marriages. That particular legislation sought to simplify the process so that it was easier for folks coming in to get married and enjoy the BVI at the same time, reduce the red tape pretty much in the registration process.
Well, what's coming in 2014? Because we can see we haven't had much success with the reduction in duties for the businesses, and I don't know how much marriage activity we've had. There's no data being supplied to give an indication as to how those pieces of legislation have had positive impact on the economy. So I'd like to hear some more concrete things for 2014. You got anything?
Oh, sure. There are some 48 of them. 48 acts, regulations, policies, and initiatives they are described. Mm-hmm. And one in particular, while you're on tourism, is the Hotel Aid Ordinance, Cap 290, and this is quite interesting because it says basically local businesses can benefit from the sale of goods that are purchased under the grant of hotel aid. So we can glean from this that folks who are in the hotel sector are likely to import items that are to be used in this sector at what one can say a pretty lower rate, or hopefully a very low rate, if not in some cases duty-free concessions. I don't want to get ahead of the legislators, but I'm just trying to basically look deep into what this is likely to offer. And that is what I suspect to be one good prospective initiative.
And
really,
so that is to make the hotels in the BVI cheaper, give a lower rate to visitors wanting to come into the BVI. Is that what that's designed to do?
I would say the same myself, because if I have an hotel and I can if I own a hotel and I can import and use items such as equipment, beds, you name it, and other measures that I can improve my structure, I am sure that that would cut my overheads to some degree and would affect or should I say reduce the overall cost of hosting my guests and pretty much drive the cost down.
The challenge always is the legislation that is geared towards helping the consumer seem to rarely get to the consumer, because the savings to the businesses is not usually passed on, or we have no evidence, or we don't measure that activity, or we don't have the data to say whether the low cost is being passed on to the consumer. Is there any legislation in regarding consumer affairs and consumer protection?
Well, you know, you're asking very, very good questions. And of the 48 of them, without being able to recall all, I can tell you that there is a Pioneer Services Act and the Encouragement of Industries Act. And this is expected to be amended to improve the marketing of investment incentives and ensure the tourism sector remain competitive. So, as you point out, it's difficult to really say how these will affect the owners of these establishments at the end of the day. I suspect that would depend on the implementation processes and whether or not the application systems that are to be put in place would be convenient or accessible for all.
Okay. Anything about opening new markets? Anything about airlift expansion?
No, the initiatives are really homegrown. They have, except of course to the final one, that speaks to improving relationships with regional and international destinations in terms of the overall foreign policy initiatives. All of the respective acts and legislations are geared at strengthening, in some cases to modernizing the legislations here in the BVI, some of which have been on the card since 1972 and have not been touched. The Education Act is one that is also said to be on the cards for amendment. There is also one that looks at the health sector, at improving the quality of services offered, and of course it speaks to the NHI. It also speaks to improving the application and the systems that are in place to govern the registration of persons involved in dental care and also those who are involved in medical care on a whole, both public and
professionals.
Private. That's right. Mm-hmm. So it's far reaching, and the extent to which we can see the benefits in dollars and cents at the end of the day would depend, I'm sure, on the capacity, the institutional capacity of the system to implement these measures after they are passed in the House of Assembly by the legislature.
It certainly seems, Sean, that the legislature is going to be busy in the next several months, in the months ahead, and hopefully we can see those pieces of legislation translate into economic growth and development. Thank you very much.
There you go. An ambitious plan, an ambitious program.
Okay, we're going to take a break. A word from our sponsors. When we come back, we're going to come back with Mr. Jeffrey Brooks. He's just published a new book. He's a curator of the Maritime Museum at HLAVISA Community College. His new book is called Building Virgin Islands Sloop, The Story of Sea Moon. And when we come back, we're going to learn all about building a Virgin Islands Sloop. We're going to learn what motivated Mr. Brooks to write such an important and historic book. And, of course, where you can get the book and what it means for us historically, and you know, get a sense of where we came from in the past, so we have a sense of where we go. And keep it locked right at the spotlight. We'll be right back after these words from our sponsors.
Spotlight is brought to you by the National Bank of the Virgin Islands, Clarence Thomas Limited, the BVI Tourist Board, and CCT Global Communications.
Calling all CCT Internet customers. Did you know if you have CCT Internet service including internet on your phone, you can connect to CCT's 4G Wi-Fi service free of charge. That means you can enjoy unlimited high-speed CCT Wi-Fi on any Wi-Fi device. Browse the web, check your mail, stay connected to any of CCT BVI's hotspots for free. Call CCT today and request your exclusive CCT Wi-Fi username and password and join the CCT Wi-Fi network. CCT, the home of unlimited.
Educational institutions are often best judged by the quality of their graduates. At the Hamilton Lapity South Community College, the educational experience offered enhances the lives of graduates and through them, organizations and communities as well. I believe HLSCC graduates represent the rich tapestry of skills, attitudes and personalities needed for any community to thrive. I am Zebulon McLean, Chief Fire Officer of the Virgin Islands Fire and Rescue Service, and a proud alumnus of HLSCC, where I obtained a Certificate of Achievement in Disaster Management and 2 Associate Degrees in Business Administration and Finance before furthering my studies abroad. I also serve as an adjunct lecturer at HLSCC and enjoy participating in the college's 2-mile race series. I fully support the efforts of HLSCC to deliver tertiary education to the Virgin Islands and the region. And now, because of HLSCC, I am making a difference.
Remember, at HLSCC, your tomorrow begins today.
For any job, be it residential or commercial, Clarence Thomas Limited is the British Virgin Islands' best choice for a wide variety of supplies to help tackle any task. Refresh the interior and exterior of your home with our selection of paint and painting supplies. For home improvements, CTL is your one-stop source for sinks, tubs, toilets, faucets, and decorative products. Convert your yard into a landscape paradise with tools and supplies from our lawn and garden center. Or visit our lumber yard where you can build that house from the ground up. Visit our convenience stores location at Passier, Port Porcelain Tortola, and the Valley Virgin Gorda. We provide something for everyone. Clarence Thomas Limited, the best products at the lowest prices, period. Locally owned and operated since 1967.
Tempt your taste buds in the British Virgin Islands this November through 2 spectacular culinary events when the BVI Tourist Board presents BVI Restaurant Week and the Anegada Lobster Festival. Top-notch chefs, spiny lobster dishes, cook-offs, a VIP dinner, breakfast, lunch and dinner menus at unbelievable prices, and tons of fun on these beautiful Caribbean shores. Festivities begin the 22nd of November and continue until 1st December. For more information, contact the BVI Tourist Board at 1-284-494-3134 or visit bvitourism.com/restaurantweek or bvitourism.com/Anegada Lobster Festival.
Welcome back to Spotlight. I'm Ed Wenk. I'm here with Mr. Jeffrey Brooks. Jeffrey Brooks? Yes, he's writing books. Jeffrey Brooks is the curator of the Maritime Center at Museum at HLSCC South Community College. He's also a history teacher, and he knows a lot about Virgin Islands history. He's an avid sailor and likes boat building. He's done a study in boat building. Mm-hmm. Welcome, Mr. Brooks. Good to see you.
Good to see you, and I want to thank you for having me here this evening.
My pleasure. Beautiful book.
Thank you.
Well illustrated, very colorful illustrations done by Lute Durant, and it's a real, real, real gem. And it's easy to follow. It's almost a children's book, but anyone can look at it and you can see the history of sloop building in the territory through this one story.
Well, it's actually is designed to be used in the school system.
Okay.
And that was our main push, was to have something available for younger primary students so they could learn about this at a young age. It was part of the Maritime Heritage Program we've been developing at the college and at the museum. But it also kind of doubles as a coffee table book. Mm-hmm. We think it has interest to anybody, adults and children alike. And even we're hoping cruise ship tourists will want to get copies of it.
Well, it's certainly a good idea. And when I didn't have a chance to really read it, mm-hmm. but I looked through it, and it brought back a lot of fond memories for me because I grew up in that period mm-hmm. of boat building. One of my neighbors, Osmond Davies, was he used to build the smaller boats. He wasn't a sloop builder. Even I think he might have built one or two sloops.
But he built a youth instructor.
But he, I know all the fishing boats in the mm-hmm. village. He built them, and at that time he had the little one cylinder seagulls.
We have two of those at the museum.
Yeah, and so it brought back a lot of fond memories for me. Your motivation, of course, is to preserve the history.
Mm-hmm.
And how did you get to compile all that information?
Well, I started, I guess, 11 years ago. I was hired, and Dr. Wheatley gave me my marching orders mm-hmm. of what they wanted me to do. And one of the tasks was to take care, preserve the boats that we had already that were in the water, to use them in regattas and any place that we could show them off. And also another task was to create a maritime museum in the brand new Marine Center. And I was very fortunate. And in my past life, I did different things, which ended up giving me specific talents that helped me in that endeavor. And so for the last 10 years, we've been building the museum. I went out and tried to gather as much information as I could. And as I did it, I would learn about the boats, and then when you start to learn about that, you would learn about the people that built them. And once you learned about the people that built them and captained them, all of a sudden you got to know what this culture was really like, and I realized how unique it is. I mean, it's like no other.
Yeah. Well, I looked through and I saw all the tools.
Mm-hmm.
that were used, all hand tools that were used to build the boats. Before you saw the tools, were you able to discern how the boats are being built? Was it a marvel to you how this is being done?
I was a carpenter before I came mm-hmm. here for 30 years.
Oh, okay.
And I knew how to use all those hand tools and had them already. But as far as the application of using them on boats, forget it, no. Yeah. And, I had to learn that all over again.
And then the cutting the material for the boats from the trees.
Yeah.
You know, I often look at that part of our history as the era of genius mm-hmm. of our forefathers.
I agree with you.
You know.
You won't get an argument from me on that.
So you're hoping that as young people, we will be able to tell, we remember, and we will be able to find out about the story of boat building.
Exactly.
Through the book. Now, when you were talking to Mr. White. And Anna Gatter and working with him on the boat, any special things came to you that you wanted to share about what you were doing?
He, Mr. White, I met him in 2003, and he told me, I took care of his boat Moonbeam, mm-hmm. and he said, well, I'm getting ready to build another one, and I asked him if I could come and help, and he said okay. And we would work mostly on weekends. And normally a boat, if you worked full-time like that, would take about 4 months to build. But because we did it on weekends, it took about a year and a half. Mm. And I would travel over there, and we would work Friday, Saturday, and Monday sometimes. And we'd start work at 7, and I'd get up at 6:30 or something. I'd come out, and he'd already been up for an hour at daylight, sharpening his tools. And when I got there on time, he'd act like I was late. He'd say, "Come on, Brooks, we got work to do, you know." And the hardest part was going out into the bush and cutting the frames and branches for the trees. And you have to have a pattern piece. Mm-hmm. And you go up and you know the right tree to go to, which is very specific.
And what was the name of the tree?
Out there we used a tree called a buttonwood, mm-hmm, and a type of acacia that only grows there called a poke me boy. Mm-hmm. And if we were building a boat here, it would be cedar, it would be white cedar, and that's why it's our national flower and mm-hmm tree. But it doesn't grow out there well enough, so we used these other woods. And you'd walk up and you see a branch that looks right, you put the pattern on it, and if it's close enough, you cut a little bit past it. And you never cut the whole tree, you only cut the branches. And that way the tree can keep growing and make more frames.
So you had this little, you had to have this certain shape.
Yep.
A certain V shape.
Mm-hmm.
And once you got that, what was the process like? What happened after that? Because if the tree had a bark on it, that piece, yeah, that you cut off would be rough.
Sometimes certain pieces we would take hatchets and trim them up out in the bush before we carried them back to our workplace. But otherwise we would just collect a whole bunch of frames. And we would carry him back to some sea grape trees he had on his property with a couple of sawbucks and some plywood on it. And then you would take an adze, which is the primary tool in traditional wooden boat building. And you would make chalk marks around the thing and cut saw cuts. And then you would work on these branches and turn them into square frames. And I had my own adze and I brought it. And I'd used it for years, but never in this application. And he and I would make frames together. And when I was finished, my frame would have like these little chop marks in it, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, it would be smooth.
Smooth? It looked like a piece of glass. Mm-hmm. You couldn't believe a human made it. It looked like it came out of a machine. And I was, I'll tell you how old I was, but he was 76 when we were doing this work. And he'd been doing it since he was 17.
And when you say square, you mean they had to have a flat surface to hold the planks?
Yeah. Okay. So you would take the round branch and you would take a compass, mm-hmm, with a piece of chalk and you'd go around both sides marking it. Then you take a handsaw and you cut down and you stop at each chalk mark about that far apart. And then you lay it on the ground and you take the adze and you pop out all those little pieces. And you end up with a perfectly dimensional frame. You can see them.
These are the frames.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And this is all from the tree trunks,
uh-huh,
tree branches. And then of course you would have the planks would go around. Did we import lumber for planks, or mm-hmm, did we import the lumber for the planks?
The frames, and we would, a lot of times we would import the lumber for the keel, which is like the foundation of the boat, and that would be made out of greenheart, mm-hmm, or another heavy wood, and we would trade with people down in Guyana. Trinidad, Grenada was a good place to source that stuff. So our boats were already trading all over the Caribbean.
And that brings me to, in the time we have left,
mm-hmm,
to the social economic importance of the sloop.
Oh,
in our history. Yeah. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Traditional sloops and boat building were the mainstay of our economy here for well over 100 years. Mm-hmm. And we were one of the four major boat building islands in the Lesser Antilles. The others were Carriacou down by Grenada, Bequi, mm-hmm, and St. Vincent, and Anguilla, and us. And not only did we build boats to use ourselves, but people came here and bought them from us, mm, and took them to other places. And the really neat thing is that the design of these boats is unique in the whole world. There's not another hull shape quite like this. And the other three islands have certain design features that identify them from those islands. But we know where those designs came from. But we don't for sure know where ours came from. Mm.
That's the testimony to uniqueness.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, go ahead. Well, so you have this unique design. You have these skilled craftsmen. And when I say these guys were good boat builders, they were on a par with anybody in the whole world. There was a guy named Voysten Pickering who built the Joan of Arc. Mm-hmm. And he left after that and married somebody in Long Island, New York, and ended up building America's Cup racing boats. I mean, he was all of them were just incredibly skilled craftsmen.
And during that time, these sloops allowed us the trade. Talk to us about that economic use of the sloop.
Within the Virgin Islands, there were donkey trails. There were no roads. If you were going to travel from Roadtown to East End or any place, you got in a boat and did it. And almost every family had a boat. Every bay had numerous boats. They carried people to school on other islands. They carried people to the doctor. We traded supplies all over. And for 100 years, we were the major supply of beef to St. Thomas. Mm. Beef and all kinds of provisions.
And of course, lots of fishing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, that's the other thing was, fish and stuff.
Well, it's great. I'm there turning the clock. But you're launching a book. What day? What
launching is the day after tomorrow, Thursday. It's at the Central Admin Complex at 4:30 in the afternoon. And the public is cordially invited to come. And I would encourage everybody to come. We'll be selling these books for $30 a piece. They'll be autographed by Lutai and myself. And then after that, they'll be available in different bookstores and at the college, at the museums. And we are trying very hard to make these books very affordable. And it's our goal that they end up on the table of every local family in the Virgin Islands and many school children. We're giving free copies to the schools. And all the libraries in the territory.
Well, certainly it's a work of art. It's very well done, very well written, well laid out, easy to follow, great story, great instructional manual.
Yeah, exactly.
Great instructional manual. It identifies all the tools. It identifies all the pieces of wood, the whole process.
The parts of the boat.
Yeah. The whole process is laid out. I think everyone really should have one. Mm-hmm. It's really a fantastic job, and I wish you much success.
Thank you.
I thank you for my personal autograph copy. Yeah.
It's my pleasure, and thank you for having me tonight.
And that's again Thursday.
Thursday at 4:30, the day after tomorrow, mm-hmm. at the Breezeway at the Central Ambient Complex. So please come out and support us. Thank you, sir.
Well done. Yes, that's a conversation with Jeffrey Brooks, and he's just written Building a Virgin Islands Sloop, the story of Seamoon. And I have to tell you, it's a good job. It's a really good job, illustrated by Lute Durant, and certainly it gives us a fantastic look at our history, our past, and for many of us who are over 50, I would say, between 50 and 70, would have lived during this period and would really enjoy having a copy of this book. We're going to take a break and come back with Shayna Smith and Judy Haycraft. We're going to be talking about the leadership conference that's coming up at Eileen Ed Parsons Auditorium, and what that means for the development of leadership in the country and how you can participate in that event. Keep it locked right in the spotlight. We'll be right back after these words from our sponsor.
Spotlight is brought to you by Tortola Concrete Limited, Clarence Thomas Limited, and H. Laverty Stout Community College.
Serving the community for over 25 years, Tortola Concrete Limited is the leading producer of concrete products in the BVI. With grades of 3,000 to 5,000 PSI, Tortola Concrete ready mix quality unmatched in the industry, and we can mix to your specifications. Our aggregates are clean through our unique washing process for our smooth, clean mix. And our special chilling process makes our concrete crack resistant. Tortola Concrete Limited is the concrete company for all your quality concrete products. Gravel, road base, face stone, boulders, armor rock, coarse sand, terrace, and the cleanest, strongest, crack-resistant, ready-mix concrete. Tortola Concrete Batch Plan serve you Monday to Saturday, 7 a.m. until the last load. Our knowledgeable, effective staff gives you free estimate and delivers on time to any location. Contact Tortola Concrete at 494-3259, Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. Conveniently located in Parkwood Pond near the BVI electricity plant. At Tortola Concrete Limited, the strength is in the mix.
Life is like a mountain you must climb. Life is like a treasure you must find. A baby learning how to talk. Just one step begins to walk.
One step at a time.
We'll lead you to paradise. Your dreams are there to find. One step to paradise.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to Social Security. How may I help you?
I'm here to find out about my husband's Social Security. You hear about that bad accident? Tis my husband get mash up. So I come to find out about his security.
I'll be happy to help you. Let me see what you have.
Man, I have plenty bills.
It's a lot of bills. Taxi bill. Hospital bill. A ambulance bill. He went to Puerto Rico.
Yeah, it was a serious accident, you know. The thing fall down and he nearly kill him.
So sorry to hear that.
So, when I go get some of that security money?
We process claims quickly. Let me just check on his contribution status. Miss, your husband's contributions are not up to date.
What? What do you mean by that?
He is registered with Social Security, yes. But contributions have not been paid in for him for over a year. I am so sorry, miss. He does not qualify to receive a benefit.
You got to be joking. He has been working all these years. What happened to his contribution? How are we going to pay all these bills? Miss, check again. Check again, miss, please. Check again.
Surprised? No need to be surprised. All insured persons should check on their contribution status at least once per year. Remember, you must secure your tomorrow today. Check on your contribution status right away.
Tempt your taste buds in the British Virgin Islands this November through two spectacular culinary events when the BVI Tourist Board presents BVI Restaurant Week and the Anegada Lobster Festival. Top-notch chefs, spiny lobster dishes, cook-offs, a VIP dinner, breakfast, lunch and dinner menus at unbelievable prices, and tons of fun on these beautiful Caribbean shores. Festivities begin the 22nd of November and continue until 1st December. For more information, contact the BVI Tourist Board at 1-284-494-3134 or visit bvitourism.com/restaurantweek or bvitourism.com/Anegada Lobster Festival.
Welcome Welcome back to Spotlight. I'm here with Shayna Smith of Smith Associates and Judy Haycraft of Ballas and Capel, right? Mm-hmm.
Capel, yeah.
Capel? Oh, Capel sounds better though, I think.
Capel. Whatever you
like. Ballas and Capel. And we're going to talk about an upcoming leadership conference. Welcome to Spotlight. Good to see you both.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Again.
Good to be back.
Yeah.
You're going to soon get co-host status.
Anytime.
You're probably the only person that when I'm talking to you, mm-hmm. I don't get a word in.
So tonight I'm going to be very quiet.
No, you're not. Well, we're already under the 30 o'clock. Mm-hmm. LeaderCast, this is what, the second or the third?
Third year.
Third year.
And what is the goal? What's your design to do?
Well, it's an annual event that we started in 2011, where we have a rebroadcast of a simulcast event that occurs in Atlanta in May every mm-hmm. year. And it is basically a gathering of leaders, but it's not your typical setting as far as, you know, we typically hear leaders, we think about political leaders or business leaders. But this is something that is reflective of society, where we have leadership that occurs in all different levels of our society.
So, and what they talk about?
Judy, what they talk about?
Well, every year we have a theme. So this mm-hmm. year's theme is simply lead. And it's really trying to find ways to create simpler ways to remove the distraction. Because I think that's one of the biggest challenges we were just talking mm-hmm. about. You know, the competing conflicts that we all have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. How do you find balance amongst all of that? How do you focus on the things that are important? How do you prioritize? So whilst all the different speakers that we have this year, they come from a myriad of different walks of life, the central topic is really how do we achieve and how do we grow as leaders in amongst all of this? Mm-hmm.
These persons that is going to be talking to us and consider themselves leaders and we consider leaders, do they have a view of competition? Because I'm not sure. I've been looking at competition. I'm not sure that competition is really so good as a motivational force. Mm-hmm. Do they say anything about that?
I think one of the things that comes out about competition is looking at yourself as a leader and whether you're holding back people in your team because you feel threatened by them. Mm-hmm. And again, I think that one of the great things about the day is, you know, if you're willing to come with an open mind and do some introspection, mm-hmm. is you can do some good soul searching through a lot of the questions that are brought up through mm-hmm. the course of the day.
And collaborating with other leaders,
yeah.
You know, you feel compete. If you're competing with these other leaders, don't you tend to lose that collaborative effort?
You do.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the things where what we liked about the event and what drew us into the event in the first place, where it is, apart from, you know, being inspired, getting a different perspective or worldview, as it were, but varied, because we have persons that come from educational backgrounds. We have persons that come from, like, the fashion industry. Last year, we had the CEO for the Burberry company, you know, talking about her experience as a leader for a, you know, global firm. And that could be applicable to somebody who may be a supervisor currently on their job, but aspiring to higher levels of management, to give them insight into what leadership is about and make you more effective in terms of collaboration. Because now locally, you're able to interact with other persons who may have similar roles, but you would normally be able to interact with and make those network connections that can benefit you.
Okay. Who you have coming?
Okay.
Who's speaking? They will not be there in the flesh.
We do not wish to mislead anyone.
Please don't come and look for Jack Welch.
Who's going to be speaking in the leader cast?
Okay, well, this year we have very dynamic presentations that will be done. We have Jack Welch, who's a former chairman and CEO of General Electric. Andy Stanley, best-selling leadership author and communicator. He was one of the speakers from last year, I believe.
Yep.
New to the lineup this year is the head men's basketball coach of Duke University and Team USA, Mike Horisky. Did I say that right?
I think he likes to call himself Coach K.
Okay, there you go. Coach K will be there. And he's the head coach for Duke University men's team. We also have Sonia Richards-Ross, the 2012 London Olympic gold medalist and track and field. Dr. Henry Cloud, best-selling author and leadership consultant. We have a Navy SEAL and star of the 2012 movie Act of Valor, LCDR Rourke Denver. John Maxwell, best-selling author and leadership expert. David Allen, best-selling author of Getting Things Done and a productivity expert. And Condoleezza Rice, Secretary of State 2005-2009. And she will also be there in an interview with John Maxwell.
So it's a big lineup.
Yeah, full day.
And the thing about LeaderCast, the company that put this product together, because essentially it is a product that gets bigger and bigger every year, is that some of the leaders, speakers, you're going to know. I mean, people like Condoleezza Rice and Jack Welch, everybody wants to hear them. Mm-hmm. But it's actually some of the other ones who have not the more interesting stories to tell, but they do have some, you know, they come from very interesting backgrounds. Yeah. Like David Allen, he had something like 35 jobs by the age of 35. And had got himself in all sorts of trouble, but then he went on. He basically came up with this productivity theory, which he then developed, and he sold it on to companies like Lockheed Martin. And now he's like a best-selling author. Mm-hmm. He has this, it's called Getting Things Done, GTD. Mm-hmm. And it's all about time management and prioritizing and focusing.
Which all of us need.
Yeah.
So we're certainly going to get from him that failure is important.
Yeah, well, he says that. John Maxwell says
that's
that.
That's how we learn.
It's kind of a common theme as well, you know, stepping out of the comfort zone, you know, knowing that you've got to get back on the horse and, you know, keep on going.
Yeah. Okay. And generally, what can we expect from the LeaderCast in terms of information, and what should it do to us mentally and spiritually?
Well, let me run through the format for the day and then Judy can fill in. As far as the format for the day, it's typically a full day. Each presentation is about a half hour long. So what we do is at certain points in the program, we will stop and have reflection, you know, where persons can share impressions that they may have or ask a question that we discuss, you know, for a few minutes before we move on. So it gives us time to kind of, you know, soak it in and see how it applies to us within ourselves locally or professionally or even privately, because oftentimes, you know, we try to separate the career from the home life, and really and truly only have one life. So it, you know, it's one of the things, especially for me with the speakers last year, it really hit home as far as, you know, trying to live two lives is very it's taxing, it's exhausting. So there are principles, there are methods in terms of combining and, you know, making yourself more productive, as Judy was speaking about earlier. So that goes through the whole day. We have morning break, afternoon break, and we have lunch. So lunch is included in the price of registration. And, you know, having a good time of networking and fellowship. Because, again, I think one of the biggest things is when persons get to interact with persons, they don't, you know, they typically won't be there. We're also anxious and looking forward to students. We have quite a bit of students that have been sponsored, so we're confirming them as well now to be a part of that group, because we believe leadership is about legacy, and it's very important that we groom our young people and give them the exposure that they need from now to start to gain the experience that they will need for later on.
And I mean, on that note as well, we still have places left, but the tickets have gone very well this year, so we have some tickets left. We would love to see more of our HLSCC students there. We haven't had a lot of registrations yet, and it's something that we say every year, that we want to see more of our young people there, because I think, you know, they particularly will really benefit from some of the lessons, the philosophies, the ideas that they're going to get from this day. And I think a lot of us, you know, we're kind of on the gravy train. You know, we go through our daily lives, you know, we're trying to get everything done, and we don't take time to stop and think. And I think this is what this day really does. It allows you to sit there and absorb all of that information, talk to other people about it. As Shana said, we do a number of networking activities throughout the day. We really try and make sure people have fun as well, because, you know, that's a big thing. You're taking a day out of work. Yes, we want you to learn, but we also want you to enjoy it and come back next year. If you're a student at the college, we have a special rate for you. As Shona said, we have a number of students already signed up from HLSCC and from some of the other schools. We also have special tickets that have been sponsored for not-for-profit organizations because we want to make sure that, you know, it's the conference is as widely available mm-hmm. as possible.
How can you register?
Call us.
Well, at this juncture, we're definitely down to the wire because this is next week, Wednesday. We haven't set the date as yet, October 16th, mm-hmm. 2013. They can call Annalie Morris at 494-9203 or myself at 541-1192. And we also have an online site, but it's a little long, so I don't know if you want to read it.
Or you can go on Facebook and just Google LeaderCast BVI.
There you go.
And it will give you all the details. So
LeaderCast BVI on Facebook.
Yeah.
And your number is 541-1192.
Or Annalie Morris. She's at the Ballast and Capel office, 494-9203.
All right, cool. And you want to give out the figures on how much it costs?
It is only $175 per person. That includes lunch and material that be given out as part of the conference. For groups of five or more, persons can register at $125. And for students, we took off $100. So student tickets are $75 per person.
And you get to hear nine very important speakers.
Yep. Global leaders. That
talk about varying aspects of leadership and how you can bring out that leadership in you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Leadership quality in you. Mm-hmm. Well, you finally entered in the club.
Oh, wow.
Anything we missed?
Sponsors.
Yeah, we want to really say thank you again mm-hmm. to our sponsors this year. Starting from the top, National Bank, Right Way, New Haven BVI, BVI Beacon, O'Neill O'Mundy Shipping, Premier Dental, BCQS, Martin Kenny and Associates, Infinite Solutions, Joma, Muran Ozans, Harney's, Oyster Publishing, Najico, and Digicel. All these companies are also affording the students and our non-profit attendees mm-hmm. to come. So they are making it possible for those persons
and
to benefit.
And we hope that they're sending their employees as well.
Yeah.
Well, of course, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they say, I just got a text, say JTB is a sponsor.
Okay. Well, thank you, JTV, for coming on board.
Yeah.
That was quick.
JTV is a sponsor.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you, Shayna. Thank you, Judy, for coming.
Thank you very much for having us.
And thanks for the leadership conference. I'm mm-hmm. sure it's going to be very important and interesting.
Yes, very much so.
Yes. We're going to come back with Laura Lee, Connor, Dr. Ronald McEnany, and Mr. Marcus Holly. And we're going to be talking about gender issues, domestic violence, status of children, the protocols if you are for victims of domestic violence, and a host of other issues, how you develop a healthy relationship. Yes, how you develop a healthy relationship. All of those things we're going to talk about when we come back after these words from our sponsors. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Spotlight is brought to you by the National Bank of the Virgin Islands, Clarence Thomas Limited, the BVI Tourist Board, and CCT Global Communications.
Calling all CCT Internet customers. Did you know if you have CCT Internet service, including internet on your phone, you can connect to CCT's 4G Wi-Fi service free of charge? That means you can enjoy unlimited high-speed CCT Wi-Fi on any Wi-Fi device. Browse the web, check your mail, stay connected to any of CCT BVI's hotspots for free. Call CCT today and request your exclusive CCT Wi-Fi username and password and join the CCT Wi-Fi network. CCT, the home of unlimited.
For any job, be it residential or commercial, Clarence Thomas Limited is the British Virgin Islands' best choice for a wide variety of supplies to help tackle any task. Refresh the interior and exterior of your home with our selection of paint and painting supplies. For home improvements, CTL is your one-stop source for sinks, tubs, toilets, faucets, and decorative products. Convert your yard into a landscape paradise with tools and supplies from our lawn and garden center. Or visit our lumber yard where you can build that house from the ground up. Visit our convenience stores location at Passier, Port Parcel and Tortola, and the Valley Virgin Garter. We provide something for everyone. Clarence Thomas Limited, the best products at the lowest prices, period. Locally owned and operated since 1967.
Educational institutions are often best judged by the quality of their graduates. At the Hamilton Lapity South Community College, the educational experience offered enhances the lives of graduates and through them, organizations and communities as well. I believe HLSCC graduates represent the rich tapestry of skills, attitudes and personalities needed for any community to thrive. I am Zebulon McLean, Chief Fire Officer of the Virgin Islands Fire and Rescue Service, and a proud alumnus of HLSCC, where I obtained a Certificate of Achievement in Disaster Management and 2 Associate Degrees in Business Administration and Finance before furthering my studies abroad. I also serve as an adjunct lecturer at HLSCC and enjoy participating in the college's 2-mile race series. I fully support the efforts of HLSCC to deliver tertiary education to the Virgin Islands and the region. And now, because of HLSCC, I am making a difference.
Remember, at HLSCC, your tomorrow begins today.
Life is like a mountain you must climb. Life is like a treasure you must find. A baby learning how to talk. Just one step begins to walk.
One step at a time.
We'll lead you to paradise. Your dreams are there to find. One step to paradise.
Tempt your taste buds in the British Virgin Islands this November through 2 spectacular culinary events when the BVI Tourist Board presents BVI Restaurant Week and the Anegada Lobster Festival. Top-notch chefs, spiny lobster dishes, cook-offs, a VIP dinner, breakfast, lunch, and dinner menus at unbelievable prices, and tons of fun on these beautiful Caribbean shores. Festivities begin the 22nd of November and continue until 1st December. For more information, contact the BVI Tourist Board at 1-284-494-3134 or visit bvitourism.com/restaurantweek or bvitourism.com/Anegada Lobster Festival.
Welcome back to Spotlight. I'm here with Ms. Laralee Connor. I'm always tempted to say O'Connor.
I don't know why.
Laralee Connor, Gender Affairs Coordinator, Dr. Ronald McEnany. What are you doing now, Dr. McEnany?
I'm doing various things, but I'm here as the Vice President of Family Support Network.
The Vice President, okay. Right. Good. And Marcus Harley. Right? I pronounced that right?
No, it's Harley.
Harley.
Yeah.
Harley. How you doing, Marcus? Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you too.
Yeah. I know Marcus as a brilliant joiner, cabinet maker. But you're here as?
I'm here as a member of the PFP Aftercare Support Group.
Okay. The Aftercare Support. Aftercare Support meaning?
After you leave the PFP program.
Which is the Partnership for
Peace. Mm-hmm. We have another group that supports us after you leave that program. There's like, who is here now to back us? So what we do is we get together as a group, like a brotherhood, and we talk about the issues of domestic violence and all of that.
So Partnership for Peace is it's not peace in the world, it's peace in the family.
It's a court-mandated program.
Okay.
The Batterers Intervention Program is run through the Office of Gender Affairs.
I never heard of it before.
Wow.
So you need to do some publicity.
Yeah, I probably do.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll talk about that.
Yes, we can talk about that.
All right, cool. So this month is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Not Domestic Violence Month.
No.
Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And the minister made a tremendous speech.
Lovely.
It was a good speech. I really
have to thank him for doing that. It was excellent. He really delivered on that.
And one of the things that he said is that victims should come out and identify their abusers, and your neighbor should, if neighbor see domestic violence going on in your house, that because you could see the woman, you could see the man running out in his pajamas with his wife, with the pot, the pot going to hit him in his head, you know, because you know that men get beat up too.
Yes,
that's right.
Yeah. So sometimes I was getting ready to say a woman running out in a nightgown. But I changed that. Yeah. So you as a neighbor, you could see what's going on.
Or you can hear it.
And you could hear the arguing and the cussing and all that, right? And so he's urging the neighbor, the community, to really get involved.
To be responsible.
Yeah. Right. But then there's a lot of fear. What do we have to mitigate that fear of the neighbors and the victim identifying the abuse?
Well, we offer support. I don't think one agency alone can handle all the problems that come along with domestic violence. So I believe in collaboration, working with each other, supporting one another for the cause. And so that's why I've made it my business to go out there, work with social development, family support network, and even the men for the after support program. They are doing a tremendous job. As a matter of fact, the theme that we're using this year, in a relationship to be respected is expected, is actually a slogan that these men came up with after they had a project to advocate for violent-free relationships. And they came up with a couple of slogans that Marcus bought. They have shirts. He's wearing one tonight.
And he brought one for me, right? A black one.
Watch your size.
Extra large.
That's one of their slogans. Domestic violence begins with me and you. And then this one here seems to be everyone's favorite. That's why we went with the theme. In a relationship, to be respected is expected. Yes, so it's not that.
So that one is mine.
What's your size?
Extra large. What size is that?
This a large.
Okay, I'll take the large.
All right.
So this is why we came up with the theme, because this shirt seems to be the one that's getting all the publicity. Everybody is requesting those shirts.
It's an excellent slogan. Now the after support, that how does that help the domestic violence victim?
What it does is it helps these men to be better communicators, and in most cases, better fathers. Better partners. Marcus can more explain to you since he's been through this process.
I was hoping that he would.
Yes. He'll deal with that.
What you actually do is we meet and remind each other that the reason we got here was not such a good reason, but the fact that we are here now is our chance and opportunity to let others know that what we did wasn't a good idea. It's very wrong, and you don't want women to be afraid of you. You don't want women doing anything for you because they're afraid of you.
So you all are a group of men that engage in domestic violence?
Yeah, yes, we've been...
The court mandated them to the PFP.
They sent us there.
Oh, okay.
So we went through the 16-week course, and after that now, it's like, we did this, we took away this training, but it's nothing to do with it. So what we're doing now is we're making sure that we speak among ourselves and make sure that we do not.
You don't do it again, and right. You discourage us from
it's
doing it.
It's a support group for them.
Yes, and that's encourage right. others not to get involved. Yeah. So we don't really want our group to get bigger because the coach sent you there.
Okay.
We want it to get bigger because I encourage you, Cromwell, to come and be a part of it and help to tell Mr. McEnany, no, do not get involved.
To spread the word, so to speak.
That's cool. So have you been able to identify what caused you to be abusive? I mean, what in our personality, and either of you, anyone could answer this, because all you have expertise in that area, whether you engage in domestic violence or not.
Well,
and I don't mean have intimate knowledge. I mean expertise from a education academic standpoint.
Basically, we know that it's got to do with, you know, control, power and control. Mm-hmm. And very often in a relationship between a man and a woman, the man will feel threatened, feels that he needs to assert himself. And sometimes it starts with, yelling. And then it sometimes continues to increase in terms of him trying to control, shout the woman down, and then eventually beat the woman down. So it's a situation that goes back to power and control, and it's got to do with communication. And I think that's what your group is focusing on, correct?
Yes.
Teaching the men how to communicate more effectively with their partners.
Yeah. But you know, we grew up socialized as men to be in control. You know, we grew up, I grew up with my father in control, and perhaps by Marcus, he's probably a little younger than I am, but perhaps he grew up with his father in control as well. And in our community, and I think in the country generally, we grew up as men being in control, providing for their families, mm-hmm. women, everybody understood their role. Mm-hmm. Here comes the feminist movement and start telling us about equality and start telling us about women wanting to have careers and they wanted a job, and the man, then all of a sudden another man find he got to cook and clean and sew. And I mean, you know, y'all really screwed things up.
I have to disagree with him. They didn't screw things up.
Listen, you changed the whole social structure of the territory. And perhaps the world.
In the world.
The whole social structure of the world. Right. And the you throw gender roles out the window. And I mean, I'm blaming that for the whole thing.
Gender roles, first of all, are learned. Okay?
Right.
So, as...
We learn them as men.
Right, you learn them.
Take care of your family, you build your house, provide for your children. Your wife is supposed to be obedient.
But it's supposed to be a supportive relationship.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's supposed to be mutual respect and shared responsibility in the household, because both parties are working now, so... There's shared responsibility within the home. And like I was trying to tell you before, gender roles are learned. Mm-hmm. And as your society or the structure of your society changes, then you therefore have to change your concept, your perception, and you have to fit into the role that is best for that union or that couple.
Yeah, so we learn to adapt.
Exactly.
So the women change the rules and then we
adapt.
No,
we didn't change. It's all about equality.
Oh. And y'all felt unequal?
Well, if you're doing, we're cleaning and cooking and doing everything in the house.
And we're out in a hot sun.
Yes, but that's not the case anymore. See, you're going right back to proving my
point. We are all not out there, so if we help out around the house a little more, then a little have more time for us.
Okay, so how do we go about now building healthy relationships, coming out of that historic background of male dominance, paternalism, as some of us like to call it?
Well, it goes back to what I mentioned before in terms of it being a supportive relationship. Mm-hmm. And basically, that's what it was, even if you look at it from the point of view of male dominance, you know, where the woman is a stay-at-home mom and the man goes out and chops down the trees, you know. Realistically speaking, that's a supportive relationship. Mm-hmm. You know, now, as was pointed out in today's world, things have changed, roles have changed. You know, some of it has to do with economics, some of it has to do with educational development that you and I and Lorelei have achieved. You know, where, again, it's where we're supporting each other.
Right.
And we need to remember that in a supportive relationship, there needs to be mutual respect, mutual caring, and that is what needs to be presented to the next generation, our children, so that they're prepared to take on the roles that have been developed.
And how do we get to that relationship as men? And I'm thinking that men, even though, you know, we're trying to say to make it equal, that women...
What do you mean to make it equal? It is equal.
Don't get upset yet, Dr. Manny. You're getting ready to bust me a good clothes. You know? Okay. What I mean is that to say that, you know, they make it seem like, well, it happens to men as well. We say men are also subject to abuse, but yes, we know the overwhelming majority is women, victims, right? That's what I meant to say, Doc. Don't beat me up yet. No violence.
that's what we promoted. No violence.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah, having come from that background, how do we learn though, as men, to adjust and adapt and have that supportive relationship when we are not accustomed of that open communication? Where do we get that training from? How are we going to help ourselves and help each other in that regard?
It comes about by being open to listening to what your partner has to say. As I said before, mutual respect and cooperation. We need to remember that we need to treat people, you know, our partners and other people, the same way we want to be treated. So there's a whole, strategy that you need to take on in terms of communication and relationships. Relationships are very difficult between males and females. Relationships are difficult between males and males and females and females. So every relationship needs work. And I think that's something that all of us need to remember and take on and remember that the work is worthwhile. Because mm-hmm. if you work on establishing a balanced relationship, a mutual respectful relationship, it's worth it. You get benefits from that. As opposed to having a relationship that is, you know, antagonistic or argumentative with each other. That's a negative relationship.
Well, speaking of negative and positive relationship, I don't know how many of us know what a healthy relationship looks like. Well, I mean,
I can ask a few questions on that. And if there's any of those answers,
the relationship is not healthy.
Yeah, it's not healthy. You know, so you could say, like, when we fight, we tend to blame each other. I can tell my partner what I really think and feel. My partner is jealous of my career or friends. I often feel lonely in my relationship. I have been physically hurt. For example, slap, kick, or punch by my partner. My partner usually cuts me off when I talk. I do most of the work. My partner often verbally abuses me, calling me names, threatening me. That's just an example. My partner cheats on me. My partner is the one who needs to change, not me.
So
if you're saying yes to those
healthy relationships, you know, any characteristic there is
bad.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And of course, what is gender affairs doing to help us to get over those hurdles? To be more supportive, to listen to each other when we talk, to share the workload, to be more responsible, to be able to open up and say what we feel without feeling that our partner's gonna get upset, and you know, you gotta keep your mouth shut. And if you wanna maintain peace, you gotta keep your mouth shut. All peace right. through silence.
Well, gender affairs, as you know, we coordinated this Domestic Awareness Month with our partner agencies. And this year, we're doing a lot more presentations in the schools. Last year, our theme for Love Doesn't Hurt, we went into the churches because we realized that there are a lot of religious beliefs mm-hmm. that keep persons in abusive relationships. And we wanted to address that from the church level. And Last year, the focus was really, really on churches. This year, we're going into the schools. And surprisingly enough, there are a lot of issues that you'll be alarmed about when you go into the schools to talk about healthy relationships. And we're also educating the private sector on the Domestic Violence Act, as well as the public sector. We did water and sewage and public work last... When did we do those, Marcus?
Last week.
And that was... I mean, we got questions. Each session is supposed to be about an hour and a half, and we were at these establishments for like 2 hours, and people kept talking and asking questions. And we usually walk with a team. We usually have a lawyer when we're doing the Domestic Violence Act. We have a lawyer, support staff, either from Family Support Network, Social Development, someone that can offer the victim support. Then we have... I do the introduction, explaining what the changes are in the act, what it includes now, like stalking, intimidation, electronic email. And we also have some videos that we are playing on the various channels, local channels, the internet, BVI Hot Press, Vino, all these places where we have the infomercials on infidelity, because our culture is so accepting to infidelity that it's not even funny. And that's a form of, that's going to lead up to abuse, because after you are caught cheating or you're out there cheating, you can't possibly come home and treat your loved one as if you're not out there doing anything, or it's going to cause friction mm-hmm. within that home. And we also have one on cyberbullying, because that's fairly new, and I know a lot of our young people are indulging in that, and we don't want our society to become accepting of that. So as a result, what we're doing is trying to educate the public basically on the cyberbullying, the infidelity, the name calling, the way we speak to each other, the way we communicate with each other. Sometimes it can be really harsh, and that can also lead to domestic violence. We also have one on withholding for control. If you're withholding from your partner 2-3 months and it's simply because you want to control the situation, that's going to lead to abuse. I can't see any good coming out of that. That's going to lead to an abusive situation where either party can get really frustrated over that whole situation. So I think it's really important to pull everything together by focusing on respect within a relationship, because if you have that respect, a lot of the other characteristics would come naturally. The honesty, the trust, the respect, the encouragement, the sharing, the mutual responsibility, the intimacy, all of that would fall in place if there's respect there.
Okay. What Laura-Lee is really talking about is education. Okay, basically what we need to do is educate the community about what domestic violence is. Mm-hmm. Domestic violence can be verbal, can be physical, can be financial.
And sexual.
Can be sexual, can be emotional. There are various levels of domestic violence. And some people just think it's got to do with hitting someone. That sometimes happens. But there are other forms of domestic violence. And people need to be educated so that they're aware of what's actually happening.
When a person feels like they are being victimized or abused, what is there now for them to do? What we have in place? What support systems we have in place? Particularly in the context of a new protocol that the minister says is going to be signed, how is that going to work? Because traditionally, there's a lot of fear mm-hmm. on the part of women in getting out of an abusive relationship. That whole It's really a difficult task to get out of an abusive relationship. So I'd like to know, when we come back after the break, what support systems we have established and how is the protocol is going to facilitate ease of getting out of abusive relationships. Keep it locked right at the spotlight. We'll be right back after these words from our sponsors.
Spotlight is brought to you by the National Bank of the Virgin Islands, Clarence Thomas Limited, the BVI Tourist Board, and CCT Global Communications.
At CCT, unlimited means unlimited. We've got the best selection for unlimited voice and internet plans available. Choose unlimited voice for only $39 per month. We'll give you a choice of unlimited usage with or without contract. Just choose one of our no contract plans. Need unlimited internet? You got it. We'll give you unlimited internet on your phones or unlimited broadband at home without no overage charges. No high bills, no need to pay for fixed line you never use. Choose CCT and join the home of unlimited today. CCT, where unlimited means unlimited.
For any job, be it residential or commercial, Clarence Thomas Limited is the British Virgin Islands' best choice for a wide variety of supplies to help tackle any task. Refresh the interior and exterior of your home with our selection of paint and painting supplies. For home improvements, CTL is your one-stop source for sinks, tubs, toilets, faucets, and decorative products. Convert your yard into a landscape paradise with tools and supplies from our lawn and garden center. Or visit our lumber yard where you can build that house from the ground up. Visit our convenience stores location at Passier, Port Porcelain Tortola, and the Valley Virgin Gorda. We provide something for everyone. Clarence Thomas Limited, the best products at the lowest prices, period. Locally owned and operated since 1967.
Tempt your taste buds in the British Virgin Islands this November through two spectacular culinary events when the BVI Tourist Board presents BVI Restaurant Week and the Anegada Lobster Festival. Top-notch chefs, spiny lobster dishes, cook-offs, a VIP dinner, breakfast, lunch and dinner menus at unbelievable prices, and tons of fun on these beautiful Caribbean shores. Festivities begin the 22nd of November and continue until 1st December. For more information, contact the BVI Tourist Board at 1-284-494-3134 or visit bvitourism.com/restaurantweek or bvitourism.com/Anegada Lobster Festival.
Welcome back to Spotlight. I'm here with Clara Lee Connor from the Gender Affairs Office, Dr. McEnany and Marcus Howley. And we're talking about domestic violence and developing healthy relationships. And my question before the break was, what are we doing and how are we helping victims of abuse to get out of those relationships and those situations easier? You mentioned several challenges, Dr. McEnany, money being one, shame being another one, fear certainly is a prevalent one. How do we help victims to overcome those particular issues so that they are able to extricate themselves from an abusive situation?
Well, Family Support Network offers supportive services by providing food and clothing, temporary shelter. Also, they offer counseling to the victim and children of the families. As a matter of fact, between January and August of this year, Family Support offered counseling to 154 adults, and during the same period to 7 children as well. So there's that type of support. Social development offers, you know, support to victims of domestic violence as well. There are some protocols that are being set in place to facilitate, you know, reporting of domestic violence. And I think Laura Lee can explain more of that than I can.
Yes, the domestic violence protocol is actually a document that will bind the service providers or the first responders. And we refer to them in the protocol as stakeholders. So it includes health services, it includes social services, legal services, which is the police, and then judiciary, which is law enforcement and then the judiciary. What this document actually does is bind those persons to have everyone's roles clarified, the gaps identified and dealt with, to ensure that victims coming through the system, victims of domestic violence, will be dealt with in the same manner, will be able to, you know, get these persons to a point where they may feel comfortable enough to press charges. Because as Dr. McEnany, we had a very heated discussion during the break where you were given several reasons why women do not leave the situation. Even though the protocol does not address these reasons, what it does do is to ensure that the service is a stronger service. It's more feasible then for these agencies to work together to offer the sort of support that they need from point A, which is the point of entry will probably be the police, and the point that of exit would probably be the director of public prosecution or his office dealing with the cases. So it's from getting them to from point A to point B.
But you know, I was making a point that if you stay, you get beat up, and if you leave, you get beat up.
But you have protection orders in the law.
Yeah, but you know the protection orders don't work.
I mean, I don't know that. I do not know that.
There's where friends and family take a part now and come in. Because if my mom, my sister, or a very close friend is getting beat up, and she decides she's not having any more of it, there's a part I know they need to step in now and be a part and help her.
And help her to do what?
Well, find ways to help shelter her and keep her from going back there.
So what,
and
is,
help
what,
out with her children.
What is law enforcement's role? Though? I mean,
law enforcement. Well, that's what law enforcement does. As well.
The judge issues a restraining. What is a restraining order? Order of protection. And it's a piece of paper that goes out to the abuser. Right?
It's not just a piece of paper, you know. it's clearly defined
right.
on what those stipulations are and what's expected of that person.
Right. And, but still, the victim is fearful of walking in the street because she never can count on a police to be there when the man is going to walk up behind her and hit her something over the head. So how does that protect an order serve as a deterrent to the abuser and a security to the victim?
Because that hit on the head has to be reported to the police, and the attacker will be picked up and arrested for violating the protection order.
I was just going to say, there are protection. The protection order has stipulations. If you breach the order,
right.
you will be punished.
That's right. I understand all that, but then I'll be dead too. The victim will be dead too. You know, I thought that there would be a stronger protocols, more protection, stronger penalties. Are those things included in the protocol?
The stronger penalties are included in the Act, the New Domestic Violence Act. Mm-hmm. That has some stiff penalties. $5,000, I believe, with your first breach,
right.
or I think it's 6 months or a year imprisonment. I don't have the Act in front of me now, mm-hmm. but the penalties are much stiffer
than
the previous.
Right. Yeah, so there are fines and there are incarcerations that can be dealt out if you violate that order of protection. So it is stiffer, as was just indicated, and people can be sent to jail.
Okay, so that's what I was getting at,
right.
what the deterrent is. Yeah,
right. Yeah, I don't think we'd be hitting too much people in the head after the first hit.
Okay.
The new Act really addresses a lot of the issues that you just mentioned, and the protocol is just there to ensure that this Act is carried out in the right way.
In the few minutes we have remaining, strengthening relationships is a task, because,
mm-hmm.
you know, I think many of us are damaged. psychologically. Mm-hmm. We perhaps haven't been raised properly. A lot of times, violence is a means of correction in our homes.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's we all come from dysfunctional families.
That's how we train, and that's how we train our children. That, you know, when I talk, you listen. You get mm-hmm. spanked if you don't obey. I commit an act of violence against you if you don't obey. How are we going to get past that, though? I mean, that's not only, you know, so in domestic violence, but certainly it's so in relationships, or daily relationships between men, women, as you said, women. We become a violent society. What are we doing?
Well, like Dr. McKinney mentioned earlier, it's educating the public. We have to move away from that sort of behavior mm-hmm. because we realize that it's not conducive for us as a people. It's destroying us. Our prisons are filled with men mm-hmm. who could be out doing better with their lives. And if you check their backgrounds, you'll find out that there was probably domestic violence in their backgrounds. Or even if you look at the sexual assault cases and how they're on the rise. These are things that are damaging our society, and it begins in the home. Your home actually reflects what's happening out in your community. And so with all these issues that we have coming up now, if you check the home, you'll see that the basis or the premise for them is right there in that home.
Right. So it's education.
And more education.
That's right.
Resocialization. We need right. to resocialize.
And what I have found is when you, instead of being Mr. Macho, and you simply ask for stuff or ask somebody to do something or even show more love and respect at the home, you get the lady, the kids, everyone to do things easier. When you start demanding stuff, you tend to get a tough feedback.
When the resistance comes.
Yeah. You know, if you just simply ask for this or ask for that, or say, can
if you give love, if you give love, you'll get love.
Yeah, that's right.
But this is what he has learned. He has been re-socialized. Because mm-hmm. if you had asked him this question about 3-4 years ago, I'm sure he would not have answered you the same way. So it is possible. This behavior can change, mm-hmm. but it's through education. We can't talk enough. We can't do enough shows. We can't go into enough schools. We just have to keep giving that message, sending it out there and being positive, knowing that it can bring about the change that we desire.
And as this month is designated, you know, Domestic Violence Month, so to speak.
Awareness Month.
Okay. We need to continue the dialogue. You know, we have a list of activities for the entire month that we're really out there pushing and doing in the community. But what we need to do is to expand it more and more so that it's an everyday discussion,
right.
both in the home, in the school, in the workplace. You know, it needs to be addressed as really a major issue, you know, in the community.
Okay. You want to talk briefly about the activities coming up?
Sure, we have quite a few activities. We have poetry competition. Well, Family Support Network is doing that. As I told you before, it's a collaborative effort. Today we were in the Breezeway. We have coming up Dancing with the Stars, October 18th. That's Family Support Network again. We have a gala, Family Support Network, at the Catholic Church on the 26th. Thursday we'll be in Virgin Gorda in the schools talking about the ACT and healthy relationships. Friday we'll be at Noah Lloyd Positive Action Movement Park with EAP, that's the Employee Assistance Program. Mm-hmm. We're collaborating with them this year so that we can get the word out there to the public servants as well. We have self-defense classes on the 12th and the 19th from 9 to 11. And men are asking if they can come. Sure, they can come. They just need to call the Office of Gender Affairs and register. We also have presentations at Scotiabank tomorrow. Like I said, we have a lot of private entities, public organizations as well. So the stress and the public schools, right. all the public schools we're trying to tackle this year. It's been hard. And education have allowed us to come in and do sessions with the principal and the teachers. I think that's supposed to take place on the 24th. Someday, the schedule is so packed
If someone wants to find out more about what's going on during this month activities, domestic violence awareness activities, where can they call in?
They can call the Office of Gender Affairs at 468-0017, or they can also call
Family Support Network.
Social Development as well.
Family Support Network is 494-7622.
Yeah. And you have a website? You could go up, come on and get this information or anything like that yet?
I believe all the information is online.
Yes.
Online.
The schedule.
Where?
I know this is on our intranet.
That's on your internet, right?
Yes. Yeah. This is on our intranet. Yeah.
Is there an address or someplace you could give out where you can check?
Yeah, I can do that. Let me check on that because our information officer has been working diligently on getting the word out there. So
okay.
I'll find out.
So, okay, so you can call Gender Affairs Office.
468-0017.
And Family Support Network.
494-7622.
Okay. Well, the panel is 3 o'clock. Yeah. And you're going to have to come back again. And you have to come back more often. You know, not just once a year when there's a domestic violence
awareness month.
Because that's not enough.
It's not enough.
And so you got to take more advantage of the opportunities that's available.
Thank you.
To you.
You invite us back and we'll be here.
I ain't got to invite you back. You call me up and I have any bureaucracy?
This is true. I usually just call him up.
Just call me up and say I want to come. You know, I don't need to know who your mother is. None of that stuff. It was good. Thanks for being my guest. Larry, it's always good to see you.
Always good to see you.
Good job. Yeah. And Dr. McNanny, you've been in the fight for a long time.
Yeah. Thank you for inviting us.
Yes. Yeah. And it's good to see you, Marcus. And
good to see you.
Encourage him to keep that fight up because he's really making change.
I'm impressed. Yes. and thanks for the t-shirt. Yes, I'm going to wear my t-shirt tomorrow. Next week, the spotlight is going to be on the tourist board. It's going to come in and we're going to talk about tourism activities in the territory, some nice events coming up, especially the first annual Anagata Lobster Festival. I'm looking forward to that, even though I don't eat lobster. but it's going to be a fun event in Anagata. So it's going to be a lot of entertainment. And next week, I think Rodney's going to be here talking about all that's going to be happening in the territory to encourage and generate tourism activity. And, you know, for our local entertainment, it's going to be great. So make sure you tune in next week. Spotlight is seen Tuesdays at 8 p.m. on Channel 55 and also rebroadcast on Sundays at 2:30. We also stream live at jtvlive.net. And if you've miss any spotlights, you can catch up on all the spotlights on jtvlive.net. During the show, you could be always streaming live, so you could watch us on your computer or your smartphone if you like. So, and whatever you miss, you can revisit. Or you do any research, you could go on jtvlive.net. Thank you for watching. Thank you for your words of encouragement, your criticisms, and your suggestions. Continue to email me at jtvspotlight@yahoo.com. I'm Ed Juenka, reminding you that when the spotlight is on, you see the facts. Peace and blessings.
Spotlight is brought to you by Tortola Concrete Limited, Clarence Thomas Limited, and H. Laverty Stout Community College.
What are you doing with your life?